Good evening, everyone. Welcome to worship this evening on the special Good Friday. Everything you need for today's service can be found in the bulletin that you could have picked up on your way in. You can also find everything up on the screen over my shoulder. The only other place you will want to reach this evening is for that red hymnal in the pew in front of you. So please join us in singing and responding in worship tonight. This evening we begin we continue our walk with Jesus to the cross. The way is laid out before us and we simply must follow. So tonight we begin worship with a special song offering from our very own Sophia. She sings of the way of suffering. A translation of that tune is also available out in the narthex. Many of you have grabbed that as well. So please prepare your hearts as we begin worship this evening.
La vía dolorosa. Por la vía dolorosa, triste día. Por la vía dolorosa, triste día en Jerusalén. Los soldados le abrían paso a Jesús, mas la gente se acercaba para ver al que llevaba aquella cruz. Él sangraba por los golpes que en la espalda recibió. La corona de espinas soportó. A cada paso encontró el desprecio de la gente a quien amó. Por la vía dolorosa, que es la vía del dolor, por aquel camino Cristo, Rey y Señor, y fue Él quien quiso ir a dar su amor por ti, por mí, por la vía dolorosa, al Calvario fue a morir. La sangre que hoy nos limpia por fe, sus huellas marcó en Jerusalén. Por la vía dolorosa, que es la vía del dolor, por aquel camino Cristo, Rey y Señor, y fue Él quien quiso ir a dar su amor por ti, por mí, por la vía dolorosa, al Calvario fue a morir.
Let us pray. Merciful God, your Son was lifted up on the cross to draw all people to himself. Grant that we who have been born out of his wounded side may at all times find mercy in him. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you now to open your hymnals to hymn 803. As we continue worship with our gathering hymn.
reading from Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see. And that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground, he had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one of whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of all of us. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for our transgressions of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich. Although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There's the microphone. Welcome back. So to sing the psalm, I will start us, and you are all invited to sing with Kent. You will notice in the bulletins there's music lines, if that is helpful for you. If not, you are singing the same thing I am. The vertical line in the middle of a word or between words helps indicate where the melody will move up or down. So please join us in singing this psalm as best you can.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning?
My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest.
Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned on the praises of Israel.
Our ancestors put their trust in you. They trusted, and you rescued them. My God, why have you forsaken me?
They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame.
But as for me, I am a worm and not human, scorned by all and despised by the people.
All who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips, they shake their heads.
Trust in the Lord, let the Lord deliver. Let God rescue him, if God so delights in him. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
Yet you are the one who drew me forth from the womb and kept me safe on my mother's breast.
I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. You were my God when I was still in my mother's womb.
Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help.
I will declare your name to my people. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
You who fear the Lord, give praise. All you of Jacob's line, give glory. Stand in awe of the Lord, all you offspring of Israel.
For the Lord does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty. Neither is the Lord's face hidden from them. But when they cry out, the Lord hears them.
From you comes my praise in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the sight of those who fear the Lord.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Let those who seek the Lord give praise. May your hearts live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of nations shall bow before God.
For dominion belongs to the Lord, who rules over the nations. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
A reading from Hebrews. After the Holy Spirit says, "This is the covenant that I will make with them. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as it is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. You may remain seated for the hearing of the gospel.
Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord. Save us as you promised. We will trust your word. Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord. Save us as you promised. We will trust your word.
For our gospel reading this evening, I invite you to take out your hymnal and turn to hymn 351 as we will sing each verse interspersed throughout. We will cue you when it is time. This is the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came with their lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had deceived the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed. I invite you to sing verse 1 of 351. Thank you.
sacred head now wounded, with grief and shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded.
Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So are you a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him and saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God." I invite you now to sing verse 2.
With them.
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'this man said, I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. We now sing verse 3. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus, where his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission. So he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. The Passion of our Lord. Grace and peace to you from Jesus, who still has work to do. Amen. It is finished, Jesus said before he bowed his head. Perhaps these were the same words on Pilate's lips, or even uttered by the chief priests as Jesus breathed his last. Perhaps they were even said by Satan at the moment of what he mistakenly thought to be his greatest triumph. But perhaps these words were said by God in heaven when Jesus finished his mission here on earth. It is finished. It is a phrase that can mean very different things. These same words could be said by an artist who has completed their masterpiece, or a spouse who wants a marriage to end. They could be said by someone who has completed their last chemotherapy treatment, or by a doctor who is telling the patient their treatment options have been exhausted. It is finished. These words can mean very different things. When Jesus spoke these words right before he died on that cross, he might have meant that his life is over. But he also might have meant that his masterpiece is complete. His mission to bring wholeness to creation has now been accomplished. It is finished. These words are ambiguous, and their meaning is determined by one thing: faith. We are here tonight because we believe in faith that these words are good. They are more than good. They are unsurpassed. To us, There are no more powerful, no more inspiring, no more awe-filled words than those proclaimed by Jesus on the cross right before his death. It is finished. It's these words that make Christianity unique, because faith decides the meaning of these words. Spoken in the midst of death, these words proclaim the end of the powers of sin and death. Spoken from the cross, an instrument of injustice, these words proclaim the end of what keeps us bound. But notice who says them. Faith is not something we do or we accomplish. Christianity is not some self-help program or self-improvement scheme for a better life. No, Christianity begins with what Jesus accomplishes on the cross with the proclamation, "It is finished." Sin and death, it is finished. Brokenness that shrouds hope, it is finished. Systems of injustice that keep the world bound, it is finished. It is these words that make this day good. For it is on this day that Jesus finished his mission to free us from sin and death. But let's be honest. Without Easter, this day would not be good. Without the resurrection, there would be no reason to call this day anything but tragic. Jesus' death on the cross finished his mission, but the story did not end. The story continued. Through Saturday, when God existed in both death and life, to Sunday morning, when Jesus sprang from the tomb, and then the story just kept going. When Christ appeared to the disciples, and again after 40 days when he ascended into heaven, and again at the day of Pentecost when Jesus sent the Holy Spirit just as he had promised to give birth to the church, to a new way of being. And the story keeps on going. As we gather here tonight to remember what Christ accomplished on that first Good Friday. And the story just keeps on going whenever we gather in Christ's name to proclaim the promise, "It is finished." And the story just keeps on going wherever we gather around Christ's table to share in his living presence among us. It is finished, but it is not over. The day after next, we will hear the story that Jesus' death is not the end. It is just the beginning. And each time we gather together on Sunday mornings, we will participate in the story of what it means that our Savior, who proclaimed it is finished from the cross, now lives. It is finished, but it is not over. The work of salvation is complete, but the mission to usher in the kingdom of God to our world has just begun. The work of wholeness is complete, but the mission of restoration and reconciliation in our world has just begun. It is finished. But it is definitely not over for us or for the world. Alleluia and amen.
Lord, be my consolation. Shield me when I must die. Remind me of thy passion when my last hour draws nigh. These eyes new faith receiving from thee shall nevermore. For all who die believing, die safely in thy love.
Let us pray, brothers and sisters, for the Holy Church throughout the world.
Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. By your Holy Spirit, guide the church and gather it throughout the world. Help it to persevere in faith, proclaim your name, and bring the good news of salvation in Christ to all people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for Elizabeth and Anne, our bishops, for Ben, our pastor, for Andy, Sue, Stephanie, Joe, Char, Tanya, Mariella, Matt, Debbie, Jill, Nicole, Mandy, and Dennis, our church council, and all servants of the church, and for all the people of God.
Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our bishops, pastors, other ministers, and lay leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church. And help each of us in our various vocations to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for those who do not share our faith in Jesus Christ.
Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife and make us more faithful witnesses of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for those in need.
Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and deliver your world from falsehood, hunger, and disease. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask.
Our Father, who art
in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. At this time, I invite you to turn to the back of the sanctuary where we behold this life-giving cross. Please respond with, "O come, let us worship him." Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. O come, let us worship him. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. O come, let us worship. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. O come, let us worship him. At this time, during the solemn reproaches, you may be seated. You are also invited to come forward during the solemn reproaches to reverence the cross as you wish. You may come, pray, mark yourself with the cross of Christ, bow whatever feels right to you.
Holy, holy, holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. O my people, O my church, what have I done to you? How have I offended you? Answer me. I led you out of slavery into freedom and delivered you through the waters of rebirth, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy, holy, holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. For 40 years I led you through the desert, feeding you with manna on the way. I saved you from the time of trial, and you gave my body the bread of heaven. But you have prepared a cross for your Savior. O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I led you on your way in the pillar of cloud and fire, but you led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I guided you by the light of the Holy Spirit, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Oh, my people, oh, my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I planted you as my fairest vineyard, but you brought forth bitter fruit. I made you branches of the vine and never left your side, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy, holy, holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I poured out saving water from the rock, but you gave me vinegar to drink. I poured out my life and gave you the new covenant in my blood, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I gave you a royal scepter, but you gave me a crown of thorns. I gave you the kingdom and crowned you with eternal life, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Oh, my people, oh, my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I struck down your enemies, but you struck my head with a reed. I gave you my peace, but you draw the sword in my name, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Oh, my people, oh, my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I opened the waters to lead you to the promised land, but you opened my side with a spear. I washed your feet as a sign of my love, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy, holy, holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Oh, my people, oh, my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I lifted you up to the heights, but you lifted me high on a cross. I raised you from death and prepared for you the tree of life, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Oh, my people, oh, my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I grafted you into my people, Israel, but you made them scapegoats for your own guilt. But you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Oh, my people, oh, my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I came to you in the least of your brothers and sisters, but I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. A stranger and you did not welcome me. I was naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. And you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy, holy, holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Holy, holy, holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you. By your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.